Hello everyone. In our video 1 of Introduction to History, we have discussed about the father of history, meaning and importance of history we have discussed. Now next we will deal with the sources of history. The one who construct history is a historian. Means the person, those who are writing the history, those who are making the records of history, they are called as historians. They use historical evidences to be a particular and authentic about history. Whatever sources they are using, it is authentic and accuracy will be there. So it is believed that there cannot be history without sources. First we have to see what is sources. Sources is nothing but these are the basic material which is needed for the construction of history. Whenever we are doing anything, first we want some material. That material is going to call as sources. And we can say that if the sources are not there, there is no history without sources. The sources of history can be classified into two groups. The first one is literary sources. Second, it is archaeological sources. Now first we will see what is literary sources. Literary sources, historically speaking, literature means the written or orally conveyed information. Means whatever things we are finding in a form of oral way and in the form of written, in the form of books, magazines, these are called as literary sources. Okay, there are two kinds in this. One is written literature and another is oral literature. Again, literary sources further divided into two types, oral literature and written literature. First we will see what is written literature. Literary literature can be further classified into native and foreign literature. Here, native literature means the literature which is related to a particular land. It is called as native. And foreign means the literature which is composed by foreigners. They are called as foreign literature. Oral literature comprises of folk songs, stories, ballads, and legends. Written literature is considered by literates, but oral literature is created by illiterates. Okay, next it is archaeological sources. The physical remains or the ruins of the things used or the constructed structure in the past are called as archaeological sources. Here in the previous year or the in the past, whatever the things are remaining or like monuments, temples, all these are considered as archaeological sources. The remains that have been buried in the earth are removed through excavation. Here when we are finding these things at the time of excavation, we are finding. Excavation means the digging of the earth by using the scientific methods to find out the objects which are buried in the earth. They are called as excavation. The scientific process in the which is very helpful in the construction of history, it is called as excavation. The historical evidences includes coins, inscriptions, monuments, pieces of pots and other artifacts. Okay, now we will see in the diagram what are the types of sources. As you can see on the screen, the sources of history is further divided into two, literary sources and archaeological sources. Literary sources means, as already I have said you, the thing which is in written form, they are called as literary sources. And literary sources is further divided into two types, written literature and oral literature. Written literature in that books, magazines, all this consider as written literature. In oral literature like stories of legends, ballads, they are called as oral literature, like folk songs. This is considered as oral literature. Here it is, written literature further divided into two types, native literature and foreign literature. Native literature means the literature which is created by Indians. It is called as native literature. Whereas the foreign literature means the literature which is created by foreigners or visitors. This is called as foreign literature. Next it is oral literature, again divided into lavanis, folk tales and historical legendaries. As I said, the stories of the great leaders, folk songs, these are considered as oral literature. Now next it is second part of the sources of history, that is archaeological sources. Archaeological sources means the things we are finding with the help of excavation or the remains of the past, they are called as archaeological sources. Archaeological sources again further divided into four parts. that is first monuments. In monuments, what will come? Like temples, buildings, forts, palaces, all these consider as monuments. Coins, you are familiar about the previously what, which type of coins, which kings are using, like gold coins, silver coins, this is coins. And inscription means engraved writing, like the things which are written on the pillar, walls, this is called as inscriptions. Lastly, it is other archaeological remains, like you can say artifacts or the other ruins, like with the help of excavation what we are finding. This is the last type of archaeological sources. Understood? Literary sources divided into two, written and oral. Again, archaeological sources is divided into four, like monuments, coins, inscription and other ruins. Now next we will see about the India as introduced by Europeans. Now we will see India as introduced by Europeans. Indians had the knowledge of history in the form of Puranas and myths from ancient time. But this was different from the European models of constructing history. Among them, Europeans who arrived in India in 16th century were Jewish priests. They undertook a systematic study to understand the lifestyle of Indian. A century later, Father Conference identified that there are many similarities between Sanskrit and European languages. Meanwhile, the British got the revenue rights in Bengal. The British officers tried to understand the history, tradition, customs, values, beliefs, and laws of Indians to strengthen their trade relationship. Some administrators were attracted towards Indian literature and culture. As a result, Manu Smriti, Bhagavad Gita, and other great literary work were translated into English. Okay, the Europeans, those who visited to India, they have translated the few major books of India like Bhagavad Gita and Manu Smriti has been translated in English. Now next we will see about the Sir William Jones. As you can see on the screen, the picture of Sir William Jones. Sir William Jones contributed immensely to the study of Indigology. Indigology means the branch of knowledge which study the Indian history, or in simple words you can say the study of Indian history. It is called as Indigology. He was the first person who has studied about Indigology, who? Sir William Jones. He came to India as a judge of the Supreme Court in Bengal and established the Asiatic Society in 1784 CE at Kolkata. Sir William Jones, who was the multilinguistic expert, translated the great work like Gita Govinda, Manav Dharma Shastra and Kalidasa Shakuntala from Sanskrit to English. Another prominent orientalist and Indigologist was Max Müller. As you can see on the screen, another prominent orientalist and Indologist was Max Müller. Max Müller was a German scholar who wrote an English book called Sacred Book of the East in 15 volumes. Next it is James Mill, a historian from Scotland who wrote History of India in 6 volumes, but these scholars were never visited to India. Now the next scholar, it is Abbe Dubois. As you can see on the screen, another historian or the Indigologist, that is Abbe Dubois. Abbe Dubois, a French missionary, arrived and settled at Ganjam near Srirangapatna. Here we have to see what is the meaning of missionary. Missionary means the religious persons who has visited two different countries to spread the religion, especially to spread Christianity. They are called as missionaries. He lived as a sage by adopting the local culture and customs. He was called Dodda Swami by the local people. He wrote Hindu manners, customs and ceremonies. He has presented Indian customs, values, thoughts, festivals and Varna Sharma system in his work. Abbe Dubois lived here for 24 years and returned to France. Apart from these few historians like Alfred Stein, Colesbrook and others, the ones have introduced the different stages of Indian history. Francis Bouchain and B.L. Rice, Flett and other European scholars have successfully recorded and preserved inscriptions. Here, inscription means the engraved writing which is written on the pillars, on the walls. They are called as inscriptions. Manuscripts. Manuscript means the books which are written by the hands. And chronological means the dates and all. They are called as chronicles. And contemporary events of the reconstruction of Karnataka history. Thus, Europeans have been successful in introducing a novel way of understanding and constructing history to the Indians. In this way, they have provided Indians a new process of thinking and a new perspective to construct history. Here, with this, we have completed about the first chapter, Introduction to History, and the foreign scholars like William Jones, Max Müller, Abbe Dubois, all these things we have discussed. Hope it is clear for you. If you are having any doubt, you can ask in the comment section. Thank you.